So hello, everybody. It is me, Demetra K, and I am blessed to be here with Donovan, the recovering Democrat Saadiq. He is joining us all the way from the dirty, dirty DR there at his usual hotel room. They said, oh, Mr. Saadiq, you're coming to town? Okay, we're going to have your sheets and your pillows fluffed. And so he's in his regular spot there. So wow, we missed him dearly on Sunday. Of course, if y'all saw the show on Sunday, y'all know that was woo. I'm still recovering from that. But anyway, thank you, Donovan, for taking time out of your vacation to do this show with me. Purpose of the Demetra K Show is to promote Black love, knowledge, and understanding of all things that go on in the Black community to make us an even better people, with the emphasis on even, because we are a great people, but we can always strive to be better. And so today we are going to be talking about two things, relationship stuff. You know, we like to do relationship stuff here, although sometimes we'll do serious stuff. Well, that's serious to us, right? So anyway, we're going to be talking about this thing that actually my daughter sent me, and I actually saw it too. It's from a page called Tonight's Conversation. And of course, you guys know we play the game Tonight's Conversation. We'll play that today, where they tackle different questions. And this one has kind of been trending because of the response that was given by the young brother. Then, of course, we're going to talk about the movie, kind of, sort of, but not really, so I won't do any spoilers. You People, that came out on Netflix with Eddie Murphy, Nia Long, Lauren London, and Jonah Hill, to name a few. It's about an interracial relationship, but there's this post that went viral on Facebook, and people are kind of having a heated conversation about it. So we're going to talk about it, and of course, play our game. So Donovan, what say you before we get started?
Well, welcome, welcome, welcome. While you guys are freezing up there, I did a Ted Cruz and decided to come down come down to the Caribbean and get warmed up and stuff. And of course, I'm with my people that know me. I'm in the same spot. A lot of people, if you travel a lot, it's always good and in your best interest to try to stay in the area that you're really, really familiar with, and people know you and know what you're about. But do us a favor, hit that like, share, and subscribe, and even become a member button. And I'll tell you what, this is a interesting topic. I'm very sad that I missed the show on Sunday. I'm going to go back and do the recast. But Demetra told me what had happened, and I'm missing for a day, and people just don't know how to act. So, you know, let's get into this, and I'll give you my honest opinion, all of it.
Surely, as you go in your Trey King voice, yes. Shout out to Trey King. Anyway, let's go ahead and get started. Here is the video. Tell us what you think. I'm going to be taking notes.
Be more impressionable. I think older women, you know, in my experience, I think younger women tend to be more impressionable. I think older women, you know, in my experience, you 30, 33, 35, the experiences that you have at that point is just, you know, a little bit too much for me. And I really think in some cases you really can't teach an old dog new tricks. So I prefer, you know, my women to be of the younger variety.
If a woman wants to respect you and give you the respect to lead and be her partner, why do you need to have that level of power over her if you're not trying to manipulate someone?
See, it's not power. It's impressionable. I've never seen a successful partnership where the other person wouldn't allow themselves to be impressed upon. If I'm a person and I got a vision, I got a plan, I got a whole program, I would think that the person that wants to be with me is willing to learn and willing to adopt some of the ways, even some of the principles that I have.
That's not impressionable. Impressionable is basically getting someone to do what you want them to do because they're easily swayed and easily persuaded to do what you want them to do.
Who said that? Did you make that up?
Well, I like
when you hire somebody, you look for somebody that's impressionable.
But
why would I listen?
Right, so you can train them. So you can, when you hire somebody, you're about to train them.
Now,
and that's why you want them impressionable.
Okay. Donovan.
All right. First of all, please excuse the noise.
A lot
of
motorcycles hear anything
and stuff going on outside. But they love to ride their little scooters and stuff. Well, you know, I look at the video and I'm going to have to agree with the guy, because When you have a group of people, and I was in the military for a lot of years, you've got to select a leader. A leader has the vision. A leader is the one that looks at people and puts them in their strongest suit so that the team can be successful. If you're not willing to go with that plan, then you shouldn't be with that company. You shouldn't be with that. So I know where he was going with that. You can't have a house divided against itself can't stand. It's not going to last. So it's just amazing to me, you know, and I don't even know why he's wasting his time at this point, because a lot of women in the United States and in the Western world, their minds are already made up. So, just cut bait to argue with people who do not want to look at another opinion or look at another way of looking at things. It's just a waste of your time.
So again, I just want to recap. He basically said that women 33 to 35, and this is the age range he gave. I guess they consider those the old dog. You can't teach an old dog new tricks, is what he said. He says they're too much for me. So you can't really argue his personal opinion about them being too much for him. Then he did say that younger women are more impressionable, willing to learn and all that kind of stuff. And then the young ladies took exception to what he said as far as impressionable. And he says, no, it is wrong. So I want to read the definition of impressionable. Impressionable means easily influenced because of lack of critical ability. Okay. This example says children are highly impressionable and susceptible to advertising. And so per what they were saying, they were absolutely right in that somebody is impressionable is because they lack critical and logical thinking. Like, it's peer pressure, right? What is peer pressure? It's to be impressed upon regardless of what it is. And so I kind of too heard what they heard in regards to him saying impressionable. I get the whole learning thing, but what are you impressing upon her? You know what I mean? It's like you're saying that the older women, I guess if I'm thinking the opposite of what he's saying, not willing to learn, and I guess maybe, and I don't want to put words in his mouth, but maybe a little bit more set in their ways. And so, yeah, not even just as a woman, but as a person, when I hear somebody say that they're more impressionable, it does kind of give janky vibes. Like, what's the word that I'm looking for? Swindler vibes. That's the vibes that I get, like almost like the pimp vibe, because anybody who has studied pimping, as such as I have, don't ask me why, I just do, study pimping, you know that they look for women who are impressionable and who cannot critically think. They wait for them to get fresh off the bus from Willacoochee, Georgia, some damn where, and say, hey girl, what you doing here? Oh, I'm trying to come to Hollywood and, you know, trying to become an actress. All right, well, I got some better for you, you know. Yeah. And we all know that as pimps, not likening this young man to a pimp, but I'm just trying to give y'all a little bit of ideology. We know that pimps, their thing is all you got to do is get the woman's mind and press upon her to do my will. And then I'll, you know, have somebody to do whatever I want them to do. So like those young ladies, I too kind of heard something that did not denote anything good.
Well, you know, I'm going to have to disagree with you in the aspect of it does not denote anything good. When two people come together, right, there's got to be a vision. Okay, there's got to be a vision of how the house is going to run. How are you going to raise the kids or whatever? There's got to come to a meeting of the minds. A real man leads because that's what he's intended here to do. That's his goal. Now, everybody always takes, I was watching a show last night and it was showing the difference between women's survival and men's survival. And it was funny, they're on these two different islands. I'm sure you've probably seen that on some of the videos and when they're talking about this. And they're on two different islands. And the way women go about doing things, it was really crazy. In the women's camp, they didn't have a outright leader. And because of that, they suffered in some of the things that they needed to do to survive. Whereas the men, upon going on an island, they immediately picked a leader and did all the stuff. Like I said, in the military, if you're a leader, you're the one that decides and looks at people. And it's not a dictatorship. It's still not a dictatorship, but you are the leader. Everybody puts their trust in you to point out things. The women, of course, women work really well together when they have to, but in a survival situation, in that situation, it was really messed up. So when you see couples and people talking about relationships and building a vision and building a house, from what I'm hearing from those women, they immediately got triggered like it's a damn thing. Okay, you know, if I love you and you love me, we're supposed to work together. It isn't a, oh, I'm going to subjugate you type thing. So there's got to be a vision. There's got to be a meeting in the minds. And a lot of women always antiquate. And this is just a question for me. And I've noticed this when I watch a lot of shows. Why is it that women, Western women, always antiquate the worst aspect of a situation? So like, let's talk about the passport bros, right? Women when, you know, look, if you go through YouTube, a lot of women keep talking about sex tourism and stuff, but yet cannot produce one incident of a perp walk in those countries of these guys supposedly doing these things. They always go to the most extreme part of it. And that's what I don't understand. It's like, well, did you listen? Did you actually listen to what he's saying? Are you applying what he's saying to a relationship? And that's what I don't understand.
So they're taking exception to the word impressionable. And I take exception to it as well, because as I just said, impressionable means that you are, it's a persuasion of somebody who does not have a lot of critical thinking skills or logic. I mean, that's just the definition of it. You know what I mean? So maybe it was a word that he didn't mean to use. Maybe he meant something else. I don't disagree with him in that he was saying somebody that, you know, can learn from him. I think we should be able to learn from each other. But if you're looking for another human being to bend and to mold to whatever it is you want them to do, I mean, that does kind of, to me, and maybe I'm overthinking to give creepy vibes. I don't want to be with anybody who's impressionable. And that's not going to be able to use their own reasoning and rationale to things. So I don't know. I can't speak for that particular young man. You also said that you were likening things to survival, a survivor. I'm not sure if I've ever seen that show before. Maybe I have. But you said
this show wasn't Survivor. It's a British show. It's on YouTube. Oh. You can see it. Yeah, it's not Survivor. But they took two different camps to show you how men and women think and act. We are totally different species.
I don't disagree with that, but you also like to liken human beings to animals, don't you? Don't you like to compare human beings to animals a lot?
Well, yeah, because we are mammals. We're categorized as mammals, and there are animals that are also categorized as mammals. So if we're categorized in that category, that would make us animals too, just have a higher origin.
I'm so glad that you went to expound that. That way it don't seem like I'm doing something janky to you. Now, also, I hear you liken men to animals a lot, and that this animal, it's like we're like animals, and it's not natural for us to want woman. So you do liken humans to animals a lot. So if I was to tell you that lioness of a lion's pride, they do a lot of the work and the heavy lifting, and really the lion, you know, he's the big bad dude in the jungle, but the women do most of the work, right? They make the pride happen. So would you also say that human women are like the same as well?
Well, yeah, that's why I always antiquate of our animal instincts. We do sex the same. All mammals do sex pretty much the same way. We both got two limbs, two legs, two eyes, and all that other stuff. We're not insects. We are mammals. We women give birth. We're warm-blooded. So we're in that same species, which gives us some of the same traits.
Gotcha. Okay, I just want to be clear. All right, and so...
Like notice in the animal kingdom, the mother in a lot of these things, cat, lion, dog, whatever group it is, orcas, even in the ocean, the mother is the one that does the thing, right?
Yeah.
The father mates, then he leaves. What do we do in general in the human thing? Same thing. And that's what I equate it to. It's like we have these traits that is a mammal trait.
Okay. I just wanted to be clear. You were on the same page here. Now, you also said something. Says Western women always go to the worst, always think the worst things, the most extreme things. I don't know how you come to that. It's just Western women. Now, you did use the example of, the passport bros doing things, predatorial, if you will. And we've never seen a perp walk. Well, just because we never seen it don't mean that it's happened. I don't think that's what passport bros are necessarily doing over there. With younger girls or, you know, doing anything illegal. I think, you know, I take most of the passport bros at their word that they're looking for a wife or, you know, a woman or whatever the case is. I don't tend to think that they're over there doing something illegal. But it's, I would venture to say it's not just Western women because when you say, why does Western women think that way? It's almost saying that the other women don't. I mean, everybody tends to have, you know, certain ways of thinking and behavior, but because I hear a lot of times the Western women being America, you know, I guess we get blamed for a lot of stuff that other women are doing or, you know, just certain things. It's like, y'all, on one hand, y'all say we don't know what the hell we doing and talking about and we ain't this, that, and the other, but then y'all giving us all this credit for influencing women and other people all the way across the water. So like, which is it?
Well, you know, let me answer that. When I say Western women, because I'm coming as a person who lives in the West from my experience of that. I can't talk about Africa or the East. So, you know, what it is. But you've seen videos where women are talking about, oh, you're going to go over to these third world countries and take over. And, you know, these women that are uneducated, the Philippines have a high education over there. Africa has high education. You know, it's like these, the people that say this, the women that say this stuff, obviously, you've traveled, I've traveled. You can tell when somebody's traveled and know what they're talking about. When I hear women talk these little things that they don't know what they're talking about, it's obvious they don't know what they're talking about. They've never been there. And it's just fodder for women who are impressionable or other people who are impressionable to think that that's what's going on when it's really not in general.
Well, yeah. And I like that you said not in general, because not all women think that way, you know, and I think a lot of the women who are probably saying that, I mean, I don't agree with it, but they're probably watching some of your passport bros over there. I got doing the upskirt type of stuff, looking up women's, you know, behinds with the cameras and, you know, doing the absolute most. Y'all know who I'm talking about. The brother that was caught up over there was in Brazil. He got ran off. And then, you know, the Zoom, the Thailand cat, you know, he's, yeah. I, every video that I've watched, he is, you know, zooming in on their behinds and the breasts and talking all up under their clothes. And so I'm not saying that's all passport bros. I think that is all extreme. Unfortunately, those brothers there, they are, the people, a lot of the people that watch them are impressionable, and I'm using that in the right way, and that they don't have common sense to think, well, wow, am I going over there to do upskirt videos? That's the old school. If y'all don't know what that is, that's when, you know, people would put a camera up under a woman's skirt or whatever,
or the mirror on the shoe and kind of look at,
am I going over there to do upskirt videos, or am I going over there to find the wife? Because if you listen to Brother Phil, you know, he talks about the purpose of passport bros is to go find you a wife and stay there with her, not to go over there and get your, you know, your rocks off and then keep coming back and forth. You're supposed to go over there, find a wife, stay. As he would say, don't bring her back here, because per y'all...
don't bring her back here.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. But per the ideology of the manosphere, you ain't supposed to bring her back, but you have men bringing her back and this, that, and the other. But when you talk about the Zoom to Thailand and those other type of videos, they're doing almost like a promotional video, like this is what you can get too. And I'm gonna keep it real. And some of the videos that I see, it does seem like they are going after women who are, I won't say that, I think some of the women are playing a game, like they're playing, but I think they're very intelligent.
It's a trick, right?
Oh yeah, I think they're very intelligent, but the way some of these brothers are selling it back to the manosphere, you too could have a dingbat for next to nothing, you know?
You know, the funny thing is we talk about the guy that got run out of Brazil, right? Look at his age. He's a young, inexperienced young man. Because remember, that he was in an interview when an older dude was telling him, don't do this, don't do that. And he was like, oh, I got it, OG. Don't worry about me, da-da-da-da. But as you know, as we get older, right, we become old fools. And I have no problem becoming an old fool. But the point is, when we were younger and you're full of that vinegar and stuff like that, you think you know everything, right? He got taught a very valuable lesson, because he was told before all this went down, whatever. And, you know, it's not really not about him. But what I'm saying is there is some truth to young people being very impressionable and being influenced by the, you know, by the right person. Of course, you know, you should be influenced by the right person, not the wrong person. But we got a lot of young people that get influenced by the wrong person. I need you to take me to the Circle K real quick. And I got me and my buddy. Maybe I need you to drive. How many women are in jail or done a stint in jail because they just happen to be at the wrong place at the wrong time with their boyfriend? You know what I mean? So there's some truth to it.
Yeah, so I would think that anybody that we're with, yeah, we want to be influential. We want to be influential in the right way. But maybe I'm hearing things too, but when I listen to that brother, I heard him saying he wants somebody who is not really going to give him a lot of pushback and he can mold and shape. And that's why I always say, I mean, a woman worth her weight ain't gonna follow just any old body because he got some, you know, extra going on between his legs. You know what I mean? And I think, unfortunately, a lot of men think that, well, not a lot, but some think that because I got the extra tools, and that's all that you need to worry about. I'm the man and you listen to me and blah, blah, blah. It's like, because what I'm gonna do, because I was born and, you know, and I acquired a lot of knowledge and all this other stuff. What I'm never going to do is play the fool for you. Now, I'm able to follow. I like I said, I love a man that leads. That is totally a turn on. I'm just going on the record. I love a man that could lead. I love it, right? But what I'm not gonna do is follow just any old body just because he's a man and he ain't, you know, giving me the right information and all that my way of the highway stuff. I'm the man. No, that's not how that works. Because first of all, why would you as a man want a woman that you that would allow you to even treat her like that? You know, like she just, like I said, a mindless just blow up doll. You know what I mean?
Well, to me, here's the difference. If a man has that mindset, he better be taking care of everything.
But see, stop everything. Right there. They not.
Right. No, but I'm just saying that's why I'm saying if he has that mindset, he better be able to take care of everything. Because if you're doing all of that, hey, you know, if that's your mindset and you're paying all the bills, all her wants, needs, everything is being provided, you could have that mindset, in my opinion. You can have that mind. But if you're not doing that, that ain't the mindset to have. And again, like in my situation, when I look for mates and stuff like that, if I'm married to you, why wouldn't you want to buy into my vision? Why wouldn't you want to do that? If I ask you to or expect you to make the bed, and that's something that, you know, I get up, I go to work, and, you know, I'm out early before you get out of the bed, why wouldn't you want to make the bed? Why wouldn't you want to make me coffee to keep me strong and going to work? Why wouldn't you want to do those things?
I mean, I totally agree with you. You know, and yeah, especially if she's not getting in the car and going to work right behind you. Yeah, she's staying at home. It should be her pleasure to do that, right? But I also want to dispel this myth, okay? Because a lot of times, some men think that because I'm providing, that's all I got to do is just bring the money home. No. That's part of it. But you also got to utilize respect, consider her input and feelings and all that kind of stuff too. Like if it's not just about the money, because if it's just about the money, it's basically glorified pimping and prostitution. You know, I got the money, you do what I say. No, it's like, because that woman is not working and you're doing all the providing, the respect is mutual. It's not, well, because I got money, it don't matter how I treat you. No, it do matter how I treat you. Because, boo, if I'm cooking your food, you might want me not to put some in there. You know what I mean? You might want to treat me like I got some respect and like I matter. So I think we really need to start teaching that. And I agree with you. If she is at home and he's providing and doing all the other stuff, yeah. Ladies, I'm going to just put this out here. Your man shouldn't even have to ask you to do any of that. If you at home and your man coming home talking about anything on the stove, why I got to cook, then yeah, he probably chose the wrong one. He should come home and the moment he opened the door, because you know what time your man is getting home, okay? The moment you open the door, it should be some aromas hitting him, you know, like, ooh, damn, baby, what you cooking? Oh, I'm cooking you some pot roast potatoes and some broccoli, you know, with cheese.
Top ramen.
I'm going to tell you right now, you can ask any man that I've been with how many times I've made him top ramen. And he going to say, well, I don't even think she had it in the house. You know what I'm saying? So, but anyway, you know, maybe you can't cook. I don't know. But the point that I'm making is if your man is taking care of business and he taking care of you, he shouldn't even have to ask. You know what time he get up and go to work? Have his clothes, you know, laid out and all that. And I know somebody gonna be like, I'm not his slave. And see, you're looking at it all the wrong way. It should be your pleasure. Cause like Donovan said, if I'm going out there, I'm going into the world, I'm working, I'm doing what I got to do to make sure that you can stay home and, you know, all of that, make it easier for him. Get up. Yeah, all you got to do is get up, you know, do what they do, get his clothes on, handle like they did, what was it, the Jetsons or the Flintstones, as he's going out the door. Here you go, honey. Have a nice day. Have him some, don't have him, you know, a Lunchable with nothing up in the lunch bag either.
Yeah, don't do a Peggy Bundy.
Right. Right. You know, exactly. That's a perfect example. Make sure your man is, you know, ready, set, go. He like, you are the backbone. That's not a disrespectful term. You the backbone. And actually, if a woman is looking at it right, you are the most important thing in the household, because without you, that household cannot function. And in a lot of cases, your man can't function. He should not have to come home and be doing a whole bunch of other stuff that you should be doing. Like, see, I'm coming from an older woman's point of view. I'm 51, not old, but older woman's point of view, more traditional in that, yeah, there's certain things that you should do for your man. He shouldn't have to worry about none of that stuff.
Right. And the last question is this. why would you even consider accepting a proposal of a marriage of a man that isn't that you know has traits of being abusive and things like that? I know it takes time and stuff, but you know, aren't we vetting our future spouses? That's what I'm saying. What happened to the vetting process? That way you would know, because all my friends that I know that have been married for 30, 40 years, these issues don't even come up to them. It's like, huh? What? Why wouldn't she do that? Why isn't he doing that? You know what I mean? It's like they know what they need to do to make each other happy. And they're still happy to this very day.
I had a Michi's mother, you know, Miss C. I learned this from her a long time ago. She said, people are in love with the idea of being in love. They not in love or really even love anybody, because it's that, you know, when you get in a new relationship, it's like, oh, they did that. And you just can't stop talking about, oh, did you see how they breathe? Oh, they just, the way they breathe, oh, just turns me on. The way they chew their food. That's like, oh, I didn't know that's what I needed in my life, right? You in love with that. But then when that stuff wear off, it's like, oh, I could just smother him. Do you hear how loud he breathing? And when he chew his food, I could just, you know. But if you're able to get past that, that's when the in love stuff fall off, right? But you have to say, I'm going into the, and this is how it worked for the, your friends and a lot of the older people. They was like, I would be lying to you if I said he or she does not get on my last nerve. You know what I mean? But I love him. He is for me. She is for me. I would not do the rest of this life without that person. And I'm not going to take what they're doing personally, right? But a lot of times people get in it, especially with that. That's why I said the internet is not real. Because a lot of times people, they see stuff on the internet. Oh, she got married. She had this whirlwind wedding.
And then they saw the Best Man Holiday and all that other, these movies and stuff.
We're going to get into that in just a minute or two. But they hear all of that. And then, you know, when it ain't, it like my another OG that I knew back in the day said, it's not like in the movies. People go to the movies, they see these love stories, and they're like, sucker, why you ain't like that? You know, it's like, well, God, this is a movie. You know, you go to the movies thinking, well, you don't do none of that for me. You know, it's like, because when they went cut, they all went home to their miserable lives, you know?
And so, ladies, that 90-day thing that Steve Harvey talks about, no, don't do that. Don't do that.
Well, you know, I feel like with that, to each his own. If you don't want to, you know, share yourself with somebody, that's on you, whatever. But yeah, so you got to deal in reality. And as far as the abusive thing, now I'm not talking about people who put the hands on people. Okay, you shouldn't be with nobody like that. Even somebody who's verbally abusive. But if you think about it, if you don't have your mind right and, you know, yourself together, you're not centered, and the other person is that way, all you're going to do is abuse each other. Whether you're saying something unkind or you're giving them the cold shoulder or, you know, something like that, you're going to become abusive to each other. And that's why you have to really get to know who you are. And I think also the other valuable thing in relationships is me time is very important. Because when you think about being in a relationship, oh, we're together forever and ever and ever. Whenever you go to the bathroom, I'm going to go to the bathroom with you. It's like, you know, it's like, no, sometimes people need just a couple, maybe a couple hours or whatever. I'm a woo-sign. You woo-sign. And then we get together and woo-sign. You know what I mean? So you got to have some space.
No. And I get that, because absence does draw the heart, make the heart fonder, right? Mm-hmm. But see, a lot of the young women, Western women, I'm going to talk about Western women because that's all I could really talk about. I'm not an Eastern person like that. I'm talking Western women. And I didn't say Black. I didn't say, I said Western women, Black, Asian, Hispanic, whatever. Western women take the context of what you just said, me time, and think that it's me time, right? Oh, I need a break from my kids. No, there is no break from your kid. The break time was before you had them. You know, and they'll drop their kids off and do all that. Oh, I need some me time. Why weren't you thinking about that before you brought the kids here? Just because you have children. Demetra, when you had your daughter, was there any break time for you? Did you say, Mom, and that me time was like maybe an hour. Your mom might say, go to the library or something like that. Not, oh, I'm going on vacation with my girls so we could go party. They're taking that me time to another extreme. And that's the thing that I get, you know. So what I'm basically trying to say is, we could say something in one context and we know what we're talking about. That same thing, even though they watched this exact video and heard and saw what you just said, they're gonna take that me time. Is like, well, I need a break from my kids. How the hell do you get a break from your own children? How?
Well, I will say this, so I agree with you. Me time is when you was making the child, right? That's when the me time came in. And so I even think for a mother, it's valuable to have some me time. But to your point, me time is not like I'm going, like you said, on a cruise with my girls for a week or so. And, you know, and I guess even in some cases, that's not bad. But this generation of mamas, not all, I don't want to say all, because there's a lot of dope mamas out there that's doing what they got to do and then some. But there's a lot of mamas in this new generation that's like, I'm tired, I can't be with the kids. Mama, can't you watch the kids? Oh, I'm going to need some me time. Well, what you talking about me time? I need to be gone to, you know, fly out of state for a week or two. And it's like,
and then they come back with another baby.
So when I was raising my daughter, I had some me time, but it was, all right, you go to the store and come back, you know? And I love my mom, RIP, I love
her. Go finish your assignment at the library and come back.
Yeah, you know, because my mom would like to spend time with my daughter, but it was never, you know, I'm finna go to the club, I'm finna go, nah. I love my mom, but it's not the time. Well, I was always one of those mamas that's like, the clubs and stuff stopped once I had my daughter. I never even really wanted to go to the club with my friends and stuff. But my mom was had the attitude, like, you had her, you gonna raise her. I will help you, you get all the knowledge, wisdom. I'll watch it for you every once in a while, you know. And when I work with my daughter's a baby, my mom and my sister did watch her that way. I didn't have to, you know, have her in daycare. So I love and appreciate them for that. But it wasn't, oh, you getting off and going to the bar. Mom, I know I just worked, I've been gone for 10 hours, but me and my homies, we going to the bar. Do you mind? My mom be like, what bar is it? Because I'm going to bring her in the car seat too. You know what I mean? So that's the kind of mama I had. And I thank God for her because I do, unfortunately, know people who are like that. And I always say, I'm not a grandparent yet, but I want to be a grandparent for recreation, not obligation, meaning that I want to be able to take the grandbabies to Disneyland and I'm going to be like, take them back to you when we done. I want to be able to do that. But the obligation part comes in. And I see this sometimes online. What kind of grandparents they got nowadays? Grandparents don't even want to watch kids. It's like, well, because the grandparents didn't raise their kids and the grandparent wasn't in the bed with you when you was making those kids. If you don't have any me time, see, this is what I tell my daughter. You settle down with a good man, then y'all can take turns having me time, babe. I'm going to go to the store while you watching, then you go do your chicken. You know what I'm saying? But you out there just pow, 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 just having to, I don't know, that was very, very crude, but you're just shooting babies out everywhere and you ain't got no, and you know, I'm speaking from a woman's point of view, okay? You shooting babies out everywhere and you're not settling down with a good man. And then you want your mama or your daddy to, you know, to babysit and all that for you.
Your family, your sister, your uncle, they all get inconvenienced because of the choice you made.
Not me and my baby already know. If you having a baby, you better be having I better be having a son-in-law too. Straight up. You know what I mean? So I'm not, you know, and because my mama didn't do that for me. But like I said, I got friends who they children had a baby and they out there. And they say, mama, I'm pregnant. Oh, okay, cool. Now mama watching all the kids and they just, you know, and keep bringing the kids back. And I'm like, nah, that ain't gonna be me. Nah, uh-uh. If that has to be me, it's gonna be because my daughter, if God forbid, she, you know, and her husband, when she does get one, they didn't work out, and for whatever reason she needs my help, then okay, fine. But I'm not going to help you in your degeneracy. That I'm not going to do, because I know that because my mom, partially because she didn't do that for me, is why I only have one child, because I raised my child. It wasn't no, where your baby at? I'll tell you, you know, she been with my mama for 2 weeks. that's not how that works. So
have you heard those stories where the girl was like, okay, I'm going to go do this and I'll be right back. And then they're gone for weeks.
Shit. My mama would put an APB out on me if I was to do something like that. And, you know, my brother, he has 6 kids. And, you know, she would help watch him and stuff. You know, she was a good grandma, but she was like, y'all had these kids. Y'all grown. Now it's my turn. You know, so couldn't be mad at her that, but you know, I and that's how, you know, I raised my daughter. Like, just be careful you get out there in the streets, which she's not, but because you're going to raise them. You're going to raise them. I'm not going to stop my life to be, you know, grandma. And not, as a matter of fact, they better not even call me no grandma. I don't want to be called granny. I don't want to be called grandma. You call me grandee. That's what you're going to call me. But anyway, that's up the road. So anyway, let's get to this other topic. Of course, this movie by the name of You People came out on Netflix Friday. I did watch the movie. It was funny. It had its moments. It's one of them kind of made me raise an eyebrow, but I won't give the movie away because some of y'all may not have seen it. But it stars Eddie Murphy, Nia Long, Lauren London, and Jonah Hill's an interracial relationship. Jonah Hill's family is, you know, staunch Jewish people. And Lauren's family, Eddie Murphy and Nia Long, they are Muslims, followers of Farrakhan, right? So they make all these references and stuff in the movie. And of course, it's a love story. And y'all can kind of ascertain what happens. And so this post went viral on Facebook. And it says, me, when I finally had enough with you coloreds, right? So you coloreds. I guess she's a, as y'all can see, it's a woman, K, two times, I guess I'm saying it right. She's referring to Black men. And the comment section was wild and off the hook. Somebody said, oh, I see the white dudes behind the desk at Facebook is just allowing this post to go viral, huh? Basically saying a Black woman is talking, calling Black men colors. And like, basically what she's saying is, I'm going to get what Lauren has here. I'm gonna get me a white dude, and you know, we're gonna gallop off into the sunset together, happy. So, of course, a lot of people did not like it, but then I did see quite a few sisters on there saying, yes, girl, yes. And I'm not laughing. I'm not laughing because they were saying that, but just me when I finally had enough of you colors, it's like, wow. She obviously, too, was surprised that it went viral. It's like, at the time, I saw it was like 30,000 shares. So, but I've seen a lot of conversation about this, even on Twitter, you know, about, it's almost like the something new. I'm going to get me something new type of stuff. That's something new is a white man, I guess. So, Donovan, what say you?
Okay, first of all, did you guys notice that she calls herself K two times? Ghetto as fuck, okay? But okay, I'm not going to, you know, belabor the issue. Here's my question, D. She says, me, when I finally had enough with you coloreds. Now, colorism, whatever, again, that's very ghetto, whatever, but okay, good luck with that. Now, let's take this out. What are passport bros saying? Why, you know, you see what I'm saying? To me, this is the opposite of what these so-called passport bros are saying. They finally had enough. We told you guys to stop talking about us negatively, all this other, whatever the tropes are out there that have been dogging Black men for 30, 40, 60 years. Now, these guys have picked up their passports and they've gone. And like Brother Phil said, these aren't the dusty so-called brothers, Ray Ray, Pookie, and Tink Tink, okay? This ain't Tink Tink, who can't get a passport because he's got back child support and all this other stuff, okay? The passport bros have been labeled as, what is that? Brother Phil said, highly monetized guys. They're established guys, right? Because those of us that don't know, if you make about $60,000 in the United States, or $60,000 just period in the world, you're in the top 10% of people in the world, right? But go to Brother Phil's channel. But see, this is what the passport bros are saying now. Now notice the kickback women have against the passport bros, but a Black woman can say this and it's silence. Nobody says anything. So what do you got to say about that?
You know, aside from it, and I don't want y'all to think I was laughing because I agree. I was just funny because it caught me off guard when I saw that, like, you colored. Colors, okay. So I just want to say this, and I agree with you that it is messed up. I also want to say that that does not represent all Black women. That young woman, she seems like she's fairly young. And I would say, unfortunately, a lot of these, and you know, some older women who think like that too, so I don't want to say it's not. But unfortunately, a lot of these younger girls are very misguided in that you think being with a very vanilla mayonnaise-y man, no shade to Jonah Hill, I like a lot of his stuff. But to think that being with a white man is going to solve your problems, I just think if you're a horrible person with a black man, you're going to be a horrible person with a white man, because if you're a horrible person, you can fake it for a little bit, like, oh, I just love that casserole your mother made. No season. Oh, it's okay.
Seasonless soup. Get used to it.
Yeah. You know, you can fake it for a minute, but after a while, you'll be like, listen, your mama can't cook. And do she know what salt and pepper is? You know, but so you can, so you changing relationships with a white man from a black man does not change you. Does that make any sense? So if you can't get along with the black man, it's a matter of time before you can't get along with the white man. You know what I mean? And so I think we need to educate ourselves. And first of all, y'all know how I feel, okay? I'm a loving brother until they lower me. You know, my daughter says she's going to create and make me or roll me off.
DeBarge is not a brother.
And let me tell you something. Watch your mouth, okay? Remember I told you the other day that it was couples week.
It was couples day. I was rolling at that
It was couples week. I'm gonna find this picture with Donovan talks. I'm gonna put it up here so y'all can show me and L's. You know, I have to pay homage to our couples week, you know, whatever. Anyway, I get into that. But you being with a white man, you know, as I was saying, I'm gonna love me a brother, and Elder Barge is a brother, okay? Now I'm gonna love me a brother until I leave up out of here, okay? So I'm not one of those ones that think that being with a white man is gonna solve my problems. First of all, my daddy would kill me. And you know, I just never been attracted to a white man. Now I've been with men who are mixed, you know, but they was definitely the brother persuasion, you know what I mean? Y'all know Al, he was mixed, very high yellow, but his mama is very dark skinned, and trust me, she a sister, you know. She would not one of those moms that's like, oh honey, would you like some cranberry sauce with crackers? Nah, she a sister.
Or one of those sisters because she has a light baby that treated him any different than she did a normal black child.
Nah, she called him with your black ass a lot. Okay, this is black ass. Your red ass. So, you know, but to think if you're going to be with a white man, and that's going to solve your problems. First of all, I'm going to keep it real with you sisters out there. And I can only speak from a woman's point of view. Sisters, can you come real close? Okay, we're going to come close. You know that when you go sit down at his dinner table, if you even make it in the front door, let's keep it real, because they don't want you there. They don't want you there. My daddy always say, go where you celebrate it and not tolerate it. Now, they might tolerate you, but you can best believe when you leave your Negro self from up out of there, they're going to say, honey, we need to talk to you. Now, you know that we did not raise you this way. We don't want Bonquisha coming back to the house. What happened to Sally? We think she's a nice girl. You know what I mean? And so don't ever, like, yeah, I know there's anomalies and there's cases of, yeah, the family, oh, they just totally love you, whatever. That's not the norm, though. That's probably the exception to the rule, right? So I know, for me, trying to inculcate myself into a family that does not look like my own, that's probably going to be very hard for me to do. First of all, when you get into a family, let's say you're a black woman, you get into a white family, can y'all imagine me sitting at the dinner table with some white folks? Like, oh, no. I know, I like black power now. I don't now, because I'm going to be me, and they probably going to be like, can y'all leave? You know what I mean? Because I'm going to speak my truth. And so either for me to speak my truth is going to be offensive to them. So I'd rather not put myself in that situation, right? Like, you don't want to go to somebody's house and just give them all, you know, the business. So that it's fantasy. That movie is fairy tale. Because for one thing, like I said, Eddie Murphy and them was Farrakhan. It was far, and you know, Jewish people on Twitter pissed off about Jonah Hill because he was a producer putting Farrakhan in the movie. How dare him? And stuff like that. And they're staunch Jews. So it's like, well, what planet is that even real? You know?
Absolutely. Like I said, you know, it's amazing how people could put a post out like that, and then the other group puts a post out, says, you know, we're going overseas to go get what we want to get, and it's a problem. See, that's where I'm getting the confusion, is that somebody who logically thinks and I critically think, why is it bad for these guys to say and make a critical choice for themselves and say, you know what, I'm not wanted here, supposedly, and I'm going to go overseas and make my choice. I don't care who you love. You can love whoever you want to love. That's fine. And you do what you want to do. And, you know, hey, I want you to be happy. That's what's going to make you happy. Be happy. But yet we run that person down who does that. But in this case, this young Black woman puts this post up. And like you said, they were like, oh, yeah, go ahead, sis. I'm going to get me one, too. It's just crazy how where we're at today in the United States as Black people and how we are maneuvered, critically maneuvered, intentionally maneuvered to fight each other over this type of stuff.
So I want to, you know, kind of take exception to what you said as far as the passport, bros. And I want to tell y'all, and I go on record all the time, I don't care where you go. You ain't going to ever be in a bed with me. So I don't care who you in a bed with, right? I mean, I can't tell. I try not to tell people what to do. But I think what a lot of people, and I can't speak for them, but I think what some women are taking exception to is that a lot of the passport bros, when y'all go over where you go, y'all like to do it in the name of demonizing Black women, right? So when you go, I can't tell you what to do, but I think you should go because you're looking for, you know, somebody to have a life with or whatever. But to say, I'm spending all this money to travel to another country from some pool nanny because I don't like the Black woman, I think it don't really have nothing to do with the Black woman, because all black women ain't like that. See, the problem that I have is a lot of the passport bros, y'all going off the stuff. And yeah, maybe y'all know some people personally, but mostly the stuff on the internet. And as I said, I don't know. I personally don't hang out with Black men or Black women that say they don't want to be with Black people, right? I don't know people like that. I know they exist, okay? Even my brother, who has, you know, dated everybody else, and he's dated a Black woman or two in his life, he says, if I ever get another relationship, he says, it's going to be with a Black woman. Because my brother, and y'all know Walter, he be on here on Wednesday, he a lot. But he says, if I ever get in another relationship, and, you know, out of this relationship I'm in, he says, it's going to be a sister. He says, because sisters are some of the hardest working people on the planet. And one thing about Walter, he ain't been with a Black woman in a minute, but one thing Walter will do, and I'll argue anybody with this, he gonna give Black women they flowers. He says, and he will not allow a man to talk bad about Black women. He'll tell you straight up, now what we not gonna do is talk bad about Black women. He says, because Black women have had to do stuff that Black men will not do, don't wanna do. He says, Black women have been saddled with the burden of carrying our race, and he said it is not right. So one thing he will do is stick up for Black women. And so what I say to that is, we should not demonize all Black women. But if y'all, if passport bros want to go find your happiness in another woman, it's a free country or whatever world, you should be able to do that. But the other thing is, you said that a lot of passports are leaving because they're not wanted. But I want to know, by who? Who are you not wanted by? Are you not wanted by the women who, and I don't want to be disrespectful, that are out of your league? Are y'all trying to get these Instagram badges that ain't real themselves? Like, who are you not wanted by? Because I've always been told, want who wants you. And as a passport bro, if that's a woman in another country that wants you, so be it. But there's a lot of women over here that will want you. And so don't get tainted by a woman that you went after, and for whatever reason, she wasn't into you. And then you took that as, oh, well, I don't want to be with Black women because of whoop, 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 whoop. And the case in point is that dude, Austin, whatever his name is, you know, he's disassociating himself from Black women, but he go over there to Thailand and let that Thai, how you say it?
That's Brazil.
No, not them, when she went to Thailand.
Oh, we went to Thailand.
Thai mm-hmm. women, you know, a woman, he allowed her to totally disrespect him. So it's like, that's why I said too, I don't think it's the one Black woman. I think it's more, in some cases, being or wanting a woman who is deemed to be a little bit more exotic. But as I said a minute ago, go where you were celebrated and not tolerated. And as a passport brother, if you feel like you're not being celebrated or whatever by the Black women that you've associated with, because you haven't associated with all Black women, then go where you feel celebrated. You know what I mean? And make sure the celebration is genuine.
Right. Now, again, that young man is young and immature, and he's a bad representative of what I would say the passport brothers are doing, because I'm not a passport bro, but I travel. And, you know, I could be in a place and there's I'm in Amsterdam, right? Red light district is huge over there. That doesn't mean that I'm partaking of that. That doesn't mean that. When I go places, people that know me, they know I participate in the local economy and I go do things and have fun and do what I got to do. But I'm going to say this. For 30 to 40 years, Oprah Winfrey, there has been a systematic thing, 30 or 40 years, where Black men have been demonized. Okay, I'm not saying two wrongs make a right. That is not what I'm saying. It is a fact that you see it in the movies. What was that thing for colored girls? Tyler Perry just does it and people think it's just, oh yeah, that's right. Oh yeah, yeah. What's love got to do with it? The color purple. So what I'm saying is the system that intentionally puts us against each other, because when I came back to America in 1988, 87, wherever it was, I came back and I was hearing all of this Black men ain't shit. Cause I didn't hear that when I was overseas in my bubble world of the military. You didn't hear that. When I come back to the States, and I still hear it today, women, you know, out of their mouths, be it young women and especially a lot of older women, Black men ain't shit, whatever. They're bitter because of their relationships or whatever. The thing is, it exists. I don't know who invented it, but it is a narrative that is out there that's been out there for years. And, you know, that's my experience with it. I've heard it several times.
You know, I'm going to have to bring up your comment about Oprah. How y'all going to blame Oprah for demonizing the Black man when Oprah has been with the same Black man since we've seen Oprah in at all?
No.
For the last 30, 40 years.
Yeah, no. When I say Oprah, as we know, she's not with the Black agenda. She's changed colors because she makes a lot of money. What I bring up Oprah is what I mean by the having that show and that platform to where other shows and platforms were kind of doing the same thing in regards to, no, I'm not saying she was, I'm not saying Oprah specifically was like, oh, Black men ain't shit. That ain't what I'm saying. I'm saying these platforms were put up like, what was that one, Ricky Lake, you know, where they're talking about like dating young girls and they're talking about, oh yeah, and I with this guy, you know, and they just kept like, oh, the Black guy really dogged me out or did that. That's what I'm talking about, these platforms that were put up.
I, you know, I hear what you're saying, and y'all know that I'm not a fan of Oprah, especially as of late, because Oprah has been doing a whole lot of, you know, tap dancing for the man, and anybody that speaks ill of Michael Jackson, we just not going to be friends, right? That's just me, so I don't really love Oprah or...
She put Michael Jackson put her on a bench. No, but go ahead.
but Oprah ain't got no power. Oprah ain't made all these platforms. Oprah ain't got not damn power to make any of those platforms do what they're doing. Oprah, I remember... because Oprah was part of the whole Got You television show too. But then when that dude on Jenny Jones, you know, marked the other dude, then I remember Oprah specifically saying, from this point on, I'm no longer participating in the Got You interview. So the Got You shows was when, because I'll give you an example, and I study these things too. Jenny Jones, y'all know Jenny Jones is the talk show with the Richard Bays and the Ricky Lakes and all of them.
The grandfather, Jerry Springer.
Yeah, but she, you know, I think Richard Bay was before even Jerry Springer, right? Morton Downey Jr.
Maury, all those guys.
I'm talking about the old dirty talk shows, right? So Jenny Jones on a talk show, she had this guy come up unsuspecting. This is why I said it got you unsuspecting, and she goes, "Well, we brought you here because somebody's in love with you," and of course she's probably thinking it's a woman, right? So this dude comes out there and the dude is, you know, saying all this stuff, how he's in love with him. And the guy is kind of like,
and then he's horrified. You could, yeah. I think the part of the show is on the YouTube if you want to look it up.
Yeah. So the guy is, you know, he's kind of trying to not lose it, but you could tell he didn't like it. So after they left the show, the guy who was hoodwinked and surprised ended up murking the other dude. You're right. And so they end up suing Jenny Jones. It was a mess. So all the other talk shows was like, okay, let's get away from the hitting people over the head with, oh, there's a, you know, gay guy out here who like wants to be with you, you know? So I remember Oprah saying that, but the point that I'm making is Oprah ain't got no power. Oprah ain't pulling no strings. Case in point is if Oprah was pulling strings, Oprah probably would be a little bit more demonstrative, but we know that Oprah was allowed to make it and make all that money because white supremacy allowed her to do that. And we've seen her be able to do that by, you know, speaking ill of Black people. So I would concede that with you, that she has gone after Black men and not been very demonstrative about Black people type of thing. But Oprah ain't got no power. And she don't have no power at all as far as that's concerned.
But the thing is, when you have something like that that goes over for 30, 40 years and it becomes part of the lexicon, it's part of the problem. Like I said, it's the messaging. You're more of a public relations person. It's the messaging that you put out there, and it's a consistent message. Because what kills me is I see these young girls, and I even talk to some of them that are here in Dominican Republic. And, oh, Dominican men, they're no good. I say, well, why would you say that? You know what I mean? You know, you have the same type of thing. And then I asked the girl, I said, what TV shows do you watch or whatever? She tells me whatever, right? But I was like, why would you say that Dominican men? Oh, they're lazy. They're this. The same type of things I hear in Western culture, I'm hearing here and in other cultures. And it's just, I'm not saying it's not true. I think it is true to a certain point. Not all of us are like that. Not all of us are, you know.
Exactly. And that's what I was going to say. Like, we got to get out of the habit of saying, and I'm not, trust me, listen, I'm not one of those people like, believe all women. Because I was telling my daughter today, I believe all women lie a lot. Or, you know, all women lie sometimes, put it that way. Or, you know, so I don't believe in that. But I think we should get out of the habit of saying, if somebody tells you that their experience with, and of course, it's not all Dominican men, just like it ain't all American men, but if they have, they might have had a bad experience with, you know, a Dominican man or whatever. So I don't think we should get in the habit of saying, you're demonizing. No, that could be, but that woman too, come on, let's keep it real, Donovan. Let's keep it real. Of course she telling you that because she know you, Daddy Warbucks. Oh, I just don't want to be with the Dominican men. They don't know how to cheat a woman, but you, hey, Poppy, you know how to cheat men, women. You know how to make us feel good. So of course she's doing all that. She see them boulders in your pocket. And I ain't talking about that sock.
I did bring the famous Speedos with me. But check this out, though. You know, like I know, Donovan knows the game. They ain't getting a dime out of me. I know. Look, when you see these girls in these countries doing all this, Papi is still sitting at home waiting for her to bring the money back. That's a fact. Come on.
Exactly. So that's why she's telling you these men are just horrible, horrible. But you, on the other hand, I wish I would have met you first, Papi.
Right. And see, and that's what it comes to when it comes about experience and being a little bit older. So these younger passport bros, they're really giving Americans, Black Americans especially, a black eye, because they're going out there, they're bringing their culture of, you know, being young, wild and reckless to these other countries that have a culture within themselves that it's unacceptable. Now, here in the DR, there's a lot of Europeans that have come here because winter is very harsh in Europe, right? So this is a destination. This town is full of white Europeans here. The police are cracking heads on like these young Dominican men that are kind of wilding out and stuff, or trying to wild out, because that will affect their tourism situation. So they're not going to put up with it. And Demetra and I were talking earlier, as we know, where Zaddy goes, there's peace and tranquility and plenty of money flowing, and they don't want nobody to stop that. So this young man and these young men that are passport bros, you are really, from the videos I've seen, you are really giving the game a bad eye. You're making America look bad because you're not conducting yourself in a mature manner. Go out there and do what you want to do. If you're going to the red light districts, and this is another thing, when I know a lot of these young Black women that I see on YouTube, Asian women, whatever, I see on YouTube haven't traveled. The biggest red light district in the world is in Amsterdam, a Western country. Prostitution is acceptable in most Western nations. Only the United States is hypocritical with a $21 billion porn industry, plus OnlyFans and all that other stuff going on, sex industry, where we're hypocritical, where we see these women that are out here tricking, but yet it's legal to have sex on camera, but it's illegal to have it off of camera for money. Doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it doesn't at all. So let's get to our car game, because I know you're trying to get out there in the streets. They're like, I hear it. Wait, hold on, be quiet. I hear them at your window. Hey, Poppy! Poppy, when you're coming outside, Poppy, tell her to shut up so you can come outside.
It is true. I come back and people do recognize me as the Duke of Edgemont, where I come from, because I come as a good tourist. I'm just a nice guy.
Nah, let's keep it real. Y'all seen the Players Club when they turned the green light on downstairs? It's like, there's money. That's what they do when they see Donovan.
And I'm going to tell you, no matter what Demetra says, yes, there was an incident in the Seychelles where a European woman tried to solicit me. I have been solicited here, but I'm not falling for it.
Let me tell y'all story time real quick, okay? We was in the Seychelles, you know, we went to Africa, whatever, was in the Seychelles, and, you know, we was the only three Negroes on the beach that was on holiday, as you would say. Everything else was just ooze and mayonnaise, you know, all that, right? So Donovan, he's on his Speedo, you know, he's going through the ocean or whatever. I'm chilling on the beach, right? I'm like, these white folks ain't gonna see me like this, okay? Anyway, I'm chilling on the beach, and I'm just looking around, and then I look into the water. I'm like, Donovan has got jungle fever. This went on for like 10 minutes. They in the water, just, you know, water, waves is flashing. The lady looked like a squid because she was really white. And Donovan's standing there in his white Speedo. And you know, I snapped a picture of that. I got it somewhere. I snapped a picture. I said, if I ever need to blackmail this Negro, I'm putting this all over the place. He talking about she was trying to pick me up. I was like, well, somebody was picking somebody up. I don't know who it was. Now, I believe Donovan when he said she, because she did, I guess, kind of just saunter over there. Hey, what brings
you? Was in my own area, minding my own business.
Wait, now what she said to you is, oh, so they let you have a break, huh? This is what you do when you're on break, huh? They let you have a break.
Remember in a caddy shack where they let the caddies go into the pool for 15 minutes?
Yeah, that was you, right? And then he was like, no, I'm actually Daddy Warbucks around here. So anyway, yeah, that, I remember that. But when we was in the DR the last time, you know, I was on the beach. And I kept seeing this spaghetti noodle looking white woman. I'm not lying, y'all. She looked like the Crypt Keeper's mama, okay? And it was a young, I don't know if he was Haitian or he was Dominican, but he was, you know, darker person, brother. And him and his white lady, they dancing all up on the beach. They had their own little music going and dancing. And she's, ooh, and he's, you know, totally into her. But then when she turned her back, he kept looking at me and Deanna. I'm like, let me tell you something. That's my daughter. And so I was like, okay, he working, because he ain't no way he choosing to be with her for free. I mean, he was just so into this woman. I was like, I wonder if they got to go a little bit further than what they doing on this beach. But anyway, I hope he was making a lot of money if he did.
Yes. And a lot of these Dominican guys are making a lot of money and they're not from this area. They come up to work.
All right. Golly. But anyway, let's get this card game going on. You ready? I'm not sure if we asked this before, but if we did, we're going to pretend like we didn't. Do you consider flirting while in a relationship cheating? Why or why not?
Absolutely not, because some people are naturally flirtatious and that's in their personality.
Describe a person.
Huh?
What's flirting? Well, like, describe me.
Flirting would be like, you know, you're kind of like innuendos when you're talking to somebody and you're kind of being... you know, you kind of make an innuendo to be a joke or something of a sexual nature or something like that. Like, you know, oh, Donovan's in it. Like, an example, like, oh, he's in his Speedos and I saw a peanut. You know what I mean? Stuff like that, you know. But sometimes some people are, it's in their personality to be flirtatious. That's just their personality. I don't think it's cheating for the simple fact that they're not acting upon what they're doing. I mean, you know, they're not getting, at least they shouldn't be getting numbers and contacts and information and stuff. Because like I said, I will tell you this every time when I travel, what do they usually do when you travel? They put a pretty girl in the hotel concierge and all this other stuff. And then you go up there and you're kind of like, then and she's like, hee hee hee. She laughs at your stupid jokes and stuff. And you kind of get that little banter going and it makes me spend more money, right? And that's how the game is played. So I don't think it's cheating unless it goes to another level.
So I'm one of those people, I think there's levels to it. I agree that some people are naturally flirtatious. Now, I will describe that. I think it's, hey, how you doing? Like you said, depending on the setting. Of course, if you're in sales, and I've been in sales before. My mom was in sales. She did sales, you know, toward the latter end of her life. And I also went into the same field. We were selling legal insurance to truck drivers at truck stops, you know. So I would, when I would go to work, my mom would be racking the, my mom was one of the biggest ballers in the company. My mom, every year, she would get these awards and these all these, my mom was balling, okay? I'm like, I can't seem to make any sales. She's like, you need to wear you some red lipstick, and then you need to, you know, not too much, but just a little bit, you know, not, you know.
Open the blouse a little bit, a couple buttons, because Demetra has her thing way up here, like a nun.
Kind of like I am now, you know, nothing, you know. She says, you got to kind of use your femininity. So I was like, okay, I did that, and it worked, you know. But it wasn't like, hey, what are you doing afterwards? I was never, it was like, hey, how you doing? Oh, you know, how you been driving long? Are you resting on yet? You know, it's like the conversation thing, right? So I get that part of it, right? But what I don't get is, and I'll say this, flirting, depending on, okay, so flirting could be the precipice of cheating, right? So what do I mean by that? Somebody comes into your inbox. Hey, you look good. Are you with somebody? Yeah, I'm married. I'm in a relationship. Oh, okay. And then, well, are you happy? And then you say, well, you know, we have our moments. Now, after she asked you, were you in a relationship? You were supposed, and you said yes. The in the story, right now she comes and or vice versa, keep asking you. Pretty soon is like, oh, you're so cute. Oh, this, that, if I was your woman, and then that's why I said it's the precipice of cheating, because it's the beginning of getting to the next level. And so for me and me only, I can only speak for me. Whenever I was in a relationship, I did not give another Negro an opportunity to even flirt with me, because if that somebody was, let's say, come in my inbox or at the store or whatever, I say this, and Donovan, you've heard me talk about this before. As a woman, I'm going to go from a woman's point of view. If you're in a relationship and somebody approaches you or whatever, and they say, hi, how you doing? There's a difference. Oh, I'm doing well. How about yourself? Oh, I'm good. Oh, okay, have a nice day. Hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm doing good. How you doing? Y'all see the difference? The other one was, hey, I'm doing good. How you doing? Oh, okay, well, enjoy the rest of the day. It wasn't no, I'm doing good. How about you? Because that, how about you? Now, again, because I wasn't interested in, you know, oh, well, you know, okay, you have a nice day. I cut it off. And so I never gave anybody else an opportunity to even try to get in that situation with me, because I only saw one person. If I'm with you, I'm digging you, I'm already fulfilled. I don't need to be trying to get my, you know, my head blown up by somebody else, because I was never really like that. So the flirting while in a relationship is something I just never did. I just stayed away from it. You know what I mean? Because I know where that could go. Somebody make you feel good and you're like, well, damn, my woman ain't said that to me in a minute. When the last time she told me I was cute? Oh, okay, I like that. And then you continue to do it.
Next, you know, just a coffee. You're just having a coffee at the Starbucks. And
oh, honey, I accidentally fell into her thing, you know? It was an accident, you know? So anyway, I don't like flirting. I don't think it's necessary. Like, I don't want you all up in another woman's face, because I don't want to have to do something to you. You know what I mean? Anyway, what's the last book you read and what was it about? You want me to go first or you want to go?
First.
So the last book that I'm reading a book now, Fall of America by Elijah Muhammad. Very good book. I'm mad that I did not read it before. And it's basically just it's kind of a continuation of a message to the Black man in America, where he's telling us about America and the people in it, the people who run America, and where they've gone all over the world, causing havoc everywhere they go, not just with us, but everybody. And us as Black people, we should be wise to, as you know, he likens them to the devil, wise to the devil and his tricks, and that he, being the white man, white people mean us no good. They never will. They'll never make the playing field even for us. They'll never give us civil rights. They'll never do any of that, because it's got to be the slave master dichotomy, right? If I make you equal with me, then you are no longer the slave. We're equal, and we know white people have told us our Black man will never have any rights that a white man will respect. They said that to us, but here we are. We're marching and you talk about people marching. You talk about Dr. King and that how he sold basically a pair, for a better, lack of better words, Negroes false hope, and that he knew that the white man was never ever going to give us equality. And that he also felt like he would have changed his mind had he lived a little bit longer. He would have come on board with the Nation of Islam's ideology. So that's what I'm reading, the Fall of America.
Oh, right on, right on. Well, there's this book that my friends have been telling me to read, and I've been, you know, trying to get to it. I finally read, I got it with me here, and I'm reading it. It's called Flight of the Old Dog. Now, this guy is called Dale Brown. He's a ex-Air Force navigator. So he used to fly B-52 airplanes. And when you're a pilot and stuff in aviation, we like to read a lot of aviation books, right? Come to find out that this book, there's an old video game of the same name, Flight of the Old Dog. And it has like a stealth B-52, really adventurous type thing. And it's an interesting book as a stealth B-52, a nuclear attack happens. And it's really, really well written. And it has to do with Air Force Cold War scenario type stuff. And they should make this book a movie, you know, somewhere down the line. I would hope that they would. But it just has to do with this, the secret stealth bomber that you have to go into Russia and bomb, you know, Russia and kind of, you know, Cold War stuff. And it's just really interesting because, you know, you're dealing with the different flight stations. Has a thing, but in the video game, and I played the video game, really, really cool. So you're playing this B-52, but you got to be the pilot, the co-pilot, the offensive weapons operator, the defensive weapons operator, and the gunner. And you got to do all these different things that are coming at you and attacking you. And in the book, what I like about books, and this is what I try to tell my nephew and younger people, the movie is one thing, but go read the book. Your imagination is just, it's just so much more. And I've always been a reader. I used to read encyclopedias when I was little. But my mind, when I read a book, when I read a book and then I go see the movie, I am totally disappointed in the movie. Very rare that I see a movie that excelled from the book. So that's the latest that I've been reading. You know, like I said, I'm on my winter holiday. So I brought the book to kind of finish up and read some of the textual things to it. And I'm going to go buy the video game because I think it came out when Windows 98 was out. So it's an old video game. But I think they have a thing or a generator where you can play it on a more modern system, but you got to have the generator or something like that. So I'm going to try to find it and do it that because that was a pretty wild game based on the book. So.
And I just want to say, too, I totally agree with you about the movie and the book. Totally different. One of the largest books that I ever read was that of It. It's almost 1,200 pages long, the Stephen King novel. And each, I like the movies that they made recently. And I understand why they have to make a whole bunch of them. I did not like the miniseries that came on TV. I was like, this is crap. Because obviously, Stephen King is one of the best to ever do it as far as horrors. And this, even a novelist, right? One of the best. And if you read his books, there's so much detail. And I was just so disappointed in the movie of the week. But Stephen King is one of my favorites. I used to read a lot of his stuff in high school. And I watched an interview and somebody says, how do you come about the stuff that you write? Like, what's going in your mind? And I think I told y'all this once where he says, sometimes he would write with a red light bulb in a red room or whatever, just to kind of get in the mood. But he says, I want to y'all to picture this for a minute. And every time I do it, I think of this. He says, imagine going into a room, but before you go into the room, you know, most of us, we kind of try to slide our hand up and down and try to find the light, but it's dark and we can't find it. And we're like, where the hell is the light switch? And something grabs your hand like this and it slides it up to find the light switch. That is so creepy. But every time I'm struggling to find the light, I think of that. So anyway, that's just a story about the book. Well, okay. What's the worst mistake you've ever made in a relationship and what did you do to fix it?
Well, I'm usually damn near perfect in relationships, but one of the worst mistakes that I would say, to be honest, was the fact that I don't operate in gray. It's hard for me to operate in a gray area. Everybody has, at least in the civilian world, a lot of civilians in my experience, like I said, I was raised a military kid and I served in the military. So I know nothing but either yes or no. I don't know how to operate in a gray area. So when I hear people make all these mistakes about, oh, well, his parents were on drugs, he was raised, you know, all these little things, I get it. But because of the way I was raised and the way that I'm tuned, I can't see things in gray. It's either this or that. extreme as it might sound, but for me, it made my life easier. Because when I see a lot of my relatives and people that were civilians that operate in gray, they have a lot more issues than I do. I would rather go without than have to have a bill. And now I got more problems because I wanted to have my kids to have a good Christmas and all, you know, whatever it is. But in my relationship, because I don't operate in a gray area, it made me a very non-tolerant to my spouse's or my significant other's situation. And I didn't, I wouldn't say compassionate. It wasn't about a compassion thing. I just couldn't compute what they were going through. Empathy is the word I'm looking for. I didn't have the empathy to go through it with them.
You know, I was thinking, I was like, damn, I'm pretty perfect too. But no, seriously, like, not seriously about that, but I'm one of those people that I think I'm pretty decent in a relationship. I love very hard, and you know, I do what I want the best for the person that I'm with. But the mistake that I've made in a relationship, oof. I will say one of the mistakes that I've made in a lot of my relationships is, okay, no. Because I don't want to, you know, be too kind of like vague. I would say is not allowing a man to be a man. I've made that mistake. And what I mean by not letting a man be a man is, oh, I can do it. I got it, you know, type of thing. And so sometimes, and my mom used to tell me that. She used to say, you got to let a man be a man. You got to let him figure it out. She says, one thing about a man is he going to go be with a woman that'll allow him to do that. And so I had to learn that. Even though I won't say necessarily this last relationship. I think I had that pretty good. But in my relationship before that, it was just, oh, okay, I'll do it. I'll take care of it. I mean, a couple of times in my last relationship, I'll give you an example. When the winter freeze happened, we went to Walmart. It was like when we could make a run for it, right? Went to Walmart and we was getting water and we had a whole bunch of water, right? Just stocking up on water. It wasn't even water I even drink. I don't drink nothing outside of spring water, but we got the water anyway, right? And so there was this older sister. She had to be like, I don't know, almost 80. And she was in there by herself and she didn't have no water. She saw us with all the water. She says, where did y'all get that water? Now, mind you, it was way back in the store. And I was about to, because we were waiting for them to bring the pallets of water. People were just grabbing the water. And I was like, well, by the time you get there, probably won't be any. And so instead of asking Al, I reached under the basket and grabbed this big thing of water too. And if you probably can't see, it's a faint scar right here on my hand. The basket, and I was just bleeding everywhere. And so he looks. He says, now, why didn't you allow me to get the water? Because he had his back turned. So I just kind of did it real quick. He says, why didn't you tell me to get the water? And I was like, oh, I don't know. I just kind of did it. And so, you know, with some things like that, moving too quickly type of thing. And so that I think that's one of the worst mistakes that I've done is not allow a man to walk fully in his manship. I don't know, you know, to do that. And so it's something that I've had to learn to do now because I have been in relationships where I kind of felt like, well, if I don't, then it won't type of thing. And so it's kind of traits that I've learned. So, I'm just saying that to be transparent because I know, especially for us sisters, we do that a lot. We feel like, well, I'll get it. I'll do it. But then one thing my mama said too, what you won't let him do, he gonna go do for another woman because innately he's a man. Right. And a man needs to feel needed and that you need him for something. But if you are robbing him of being a man, even in those little moments, he will go do it, you know, with that woman who's the damsel. I don't think I can. Can you lift that nail file for me? You know, they like that. So that's what I'm learning to do a little bit is to, you know, to kind of kick back a little bit. And I mean, not that I have a man to do that for now, but I'm learning. And I'll give you a perfect example. I was hanging out, you know, with somebody yesterday on the friendship level, nothing like that. And we were doing something to my car. And that part of me was like, I kind of saw him struggling a little bit. And that part of me was like, oh, I can easily do it. I could do it. I could do it like that. But I had a conversation with myself. Shut your ass up. Don't you say nothing. And I didn't until, you know, he was like, yeah, okay, I can use a little help. And I was like, oh, okay, you know, but that was so hard for me, but I'm learning, you know what I mean? So that's what I'm doing to fix it, is just to have a conversation with myself. Shut your ass up.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up, because that's a lot of mistakes women make, especially when you're vetting a man. Okay, let's say, you know, and you're wrong, you want to be strong and independent, that's fine. But you got to understand men's nature is to be wanted to do something and to protect, and all the four P's that are out there: protect, provision, guidance, whatever we're doing. And yeah, we know you could do it. There's no doubt. Okay. Yeah, you could do it. But just because you could do it, does it mean you should?
Right. You know, and I'm telling you, you know, I love being able to just, because I'm a daddy's girl, right? And my dad, I learned those things from my dad. My dad would do it. Don't worry, I do it. Mm-hmm. Back, don't you do nothing. And so I'm just really learning to really sit in my softness and my femininity, and, you know, allowing a man to do stuff. And I'm learning, and I like it. I'm really enjoying that, you know. But my mom, on the other hand, she was like, shoot, I don't know how to do nothing, you know.
Right. But, you know, but think about it this way, ladies. That's also a great way to vet if your man is really that prototypical man that you're looking for. Because a lot of women, can he fix a car? You know, let's say simple as changing the oil in a car. If a man cannot do that, and he'd rather pay money for something that takes 15 minutes, you might not really have a man on your hands.
Well, you know, I'm gonna disagree with that just tiny, because I get you. You know, y'all know my brother Walter. Shoot, my brother is the son of a mechanic, so he knows his way around the car. But Walter's, and he's in the car business, so he does fix cars and stuff. But Walter is not above letting somebody else detail the car, change the oil, because, you know, Walter like to run around in his nice little clothes and all that stuff. So he's like, I don't have a problem with people doing it, but I get what you're saying. Does he know how to do it? And for me, maybe this is me not, you know, letting a man be a man too. So you can correct me if I'm wrong, Donovan. If you just know how to go to YouTube, can you YouTube how to do it? Can you Google it? If you can at least do that and get it, work your way, that's a turn on to me too. But saying, well, I don't know how to do it, it's like,
There comes the arguments. Oh, but, you know, my daddy knows how to do it. Like I said,
not to cut you off. But that's one thing I talk about my daddy a lot, yeah. But I would never compare my dad to a man and say, well, my daddy would not.
A lot of women do that. But like you said, like Walter knows how to do it, like me. I know how to do a lot of stuff, but I'm also of means where, yeah, I have no problem paying it. The thing is, though, if the shit hit the fan, could I do it? That's the difference. And that's what I'm saying, ladies. I'm not saying if you guys got means and you guys built together and you got that money. I got friends right now. Whenever we go places, we park, like when we went to a crypto center or something like that, and you know where they got the $50 parking and stuff and whatever. They park valet at the center. We have to go down the street and around the corner to get the $10 parking. You know what I mean? Because that's how they roll, you know?
But so you said you would pay for valet.
No, my friends would pay. I wouldn't.
Oh, yeah, I'm with you, but we could walk. We could save $40 by walking. We've earned a $40 by walking. See, I'm with you on that one, too. I'm not, well, I ain't trying to walk. Because, you know, I've gone to different places, you know, with men who say, okay, I know with a $10 parking. See, I like that. I like that, you know, to save money. Listen, I don't have a problem with walking. One thing I can do is walk. If it's going to save you some money, I'm not going to never judge you because you are, you know, fiscally responsible. And I like that.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, like Walter, he knows how to do it. And he's in a position where he can pay somebody else. That's fine. But what kills me is you find these women, you know, they met the guy, whatever, and they find out they get frustrated because he can't do this or he can't do that or he can't do this for whatever reasons. You should have vetted that guy before and figured it out.
But the other thing too is, because this is just me, are you willing to learn? Or are you just one of those people, I don't know how to do that, I'm not going to do it. Are you going to say, you know what? Because it's true, you don't know how to do everything, right? But are you willing to learn how to do it? If you're willing to learn, I'm with it. That, like, that's turn on to me too. But it's a man is just like, I don't know how to do that. I'm just saying.
Fellas, let me tell you something. Even with some of these women, not every woman's the same. So she might have to tell you, that ain't how you do it on me. It's the truth. It's the same concept. You gotta be willing to learn.
Right, Tom. I know what I'm doing. Lay still. Just take it. Now, what you're gonna do is get up off of me with that little 2 minutes that has. It's gonna take you a minute and a half to even figure it out. Now, all I got left is 30 seconds for me. So anyway, y'all, we're gonna get out here, let Donovan go hit the streets and do what he do. I know the women is looking for him. So we'll be back here with Walter. What is that? Are you going scuba diving?
Yes, I am going scuba diving.
Okay. You gonna have the have you seen Step Brothers? Who would say the boats and holes? Boats and
the funny thing is there's a lot of women out there that hope that remember that TV show back in the day or movie Open Water?
Yes.
Where you get left behind.
Okay, don't be out there like what's his name? Tom Hanks, Castaway.
Castaway, right.
So anyway, we love and appreciate y'all. Thank y'all so much for being here with us on this fine Tuesday podcast. Of course, we have ways to help the channel if you choose to do so. If not, at the very least, like, subscribe, become a member. Love to have you here. Be back here with Walter Wealth Wednesdays. I'm going to try to have people come back on live. But for those of y'all that was there on Sunday and y'all saw what I saw, I'm still recovering from that a little bit. I'm going to try to figure out a way to make that easy so that, you know, the sickos don't come on and do stuff like that. Oh, my God.
Right. And real quick, isn't it funny how Maxine Waters and the Democrats, Reverend Al, and other people are now talking about qualified immunity as a serious situation. So later on in the week, maybe we could talk about that. Or I know on my podcast, I'll be talking about that. Because think about this. If, and you haven't heard a word from Jim Clyburn, not a word. Well, we don't need no qualified immunity. We can talk about that later. This man could possibly have been alive if qualified immunity was on the books. And guess what? When all these officers get prosecuted and the lawsuit comes and Ben Crump gets it, we pay for that. The taxpayer is going to pay for that. They're and it shouldn't complicit. Be that way.
They're all of them complicit. So don't talk about it now. Maxine and all of y'all complicit because y'all let it roll to get the infrastructure bill passed. Y'all said, well, we'll forego that right now and pick it up another time. And y'all, they never said nothing else about it until.
Qualified immunity should not be negotiated. It is nothing to negotiate. It's either it's going to be in the bill or there's no bill.
And guess the F what? I almost said it, y'all, because I'm very passionate about this. They're also now talking more about Black men are continuing to leave the Democratic Party. And so who is most affected by police brutality is Black men. And the very people that are mad that y'all leaving did not do anything to protect y'all and give you a reason to stay. So now they got to talk about it because it's like, now we're going to give Black men another reason to leave because we allowed these police officers to go rogue and unhinged and do what they're doing to Black men who we happen to need. So,
And just real quick, this goes also back to how we are now being programmed to go from tragedy to tragedy to tragedy to tragedy. And it doesn't matter how heinous to what we just saw. We thought George Floyd was heinous. What I saw in that video, that young man being brutalized by the blue Black police officers. And I say blue because Black police officers and Black military people were green before we're Black. They're blue before they're Black. What they did right there, and here's the capper, Demetra, because I've been doing some research on it while I've been over here. The police chief who came from Atlanta via Durham, whatever, she had two other special squads that were deactivated because of brutality in situations like that. So this thing is deep, people. So we need to get into that a little bit.
Yeah, those squads are trash. Just trash. They just, you know, brutalize people. So yeah, we could talk about that. You know, if you want to come on another day or, you know, me on your podcast or whatever, just let me know. And we'll definitely do that. So anyway, we're going to get out here. We love and appreciate y'all dearly. Y'all please have a great rest of your day. Peace.